Welcome to Parkside Fellowship Worship Online. My name is Roger Sharp and I'm the Associate Pastor. Isn't 2020 just crazy? Right when you think one thing's done, something else comes along. It's just been 6 months of turmoil and chaos and change. But one thing we know for sure as believers is that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We place our hope and our trust in Him, knowing that He is the sole worship of our faith. Hey, just a few announcements before we begin today. Mark your calendar next Sunday, June the 14th from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. We'll have our barbecue out in the church parking lot. Everything's gonna take place outside. Be sure to bring your favorite lawn chair and something to drink, and we'll provide the hamburgers and the hot dogs. The point is just to get together, see each other, talk to each other 6 feet apart, and to enjoy each other. We're putting the theme on this as our homecoming, because it's been a few months and it feels like a homecoming. And I hope that you'll come out and join us next Sunday. Also, discipleship plans are in play for August and September and October. So be looking for more information as those come out. Well, let's enjoy our time of worship together. Would you join me as we pray this morning? Father God, we thank You, as Hebrews 13:8 tells us, that You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Father, we thank You for that consistency, knowing that we worship You, that we come and bring all that we can to worship, knowing, Father, that You are the one that holds all truth, that holds all love. And Father, we thank You for that promise to us. We pray that You would open our eyes, open our hearts, open our minds this morning as we dive into Titus. Help us to retain throughout the week what we need to retain as we live out our Christian beliefs. Father, thank You for the opportunities before us. Thank You for those people You place in our lives that we can share the gospel message with. We know that this is a hurting world, and we know that, Father, we have the only answer. Help us to be good ambassadors of Your message. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You take yet beautiful, restores, refines. Lord, You're merciful, redeem, revive.
alone.
Good morning, Parkside. Thanks for joining me here this morning. Well, what a week, what a week and a half we've had here in our city and in our nation. And while it would be easy, for me to dive right into Titus and ask you to take your Bibles and open them up and just act like nothing's going on, I believe as your pastor, it's important for me to briefly kind of address the events of the past several days and how I think God would want us to respond. So real quick, before we dive into Titus, let's be honest with ourselves. The death of George Floyd, it was wrong on every level. And it has brought to light an issue that we tend to shy away from as a church, and that is this. There's racial inequality in our country and in our world. We have a race problem. Let's just admit that. And now with the senseless killing of George Floyd, who is one of many who have been killed for being black, Christians are finally asking the question, what should our response be to racial inequality? Well, I believe our response is in the two greatest commandments of the Bible, to love God and love others. To love as Jesus loved. And that begs the question, well, how did Jesus love? Well, Paul describes for us the type of love that Jesus wants us to have when he wrote these words in Philippians 2:3. Be humble. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Our response to what is happening in our nation needs to be one that's filled with humility and love. Seeing others as greater than ourselves and fighting for social justice. So how do we begin to do this? We begin by showing an interest in others who are not like us. We begin by listening. Racial reconciliation begins with relationships. So you want to know where to start? Invite someone of a different race to sit down and talk with you about how they feel, about what they're feeling, about what their beliefs are. Pray for them. Let them know that you're interested in getting to know them better. This is how the church can begin to be an agent of change in our society. And before we continue our study in Titus, I'm going to ask you to take 30 seconds and to ask God to help you to love others the way Jesus did, and to ask God to heal our land. Would you just bow your heads and spend a brief moment in prayer, and then I will lead us in prayer. So now, God, I ask that you would heal our land. Lord, that you would use your church as an agent of transformation. God, that we would show the kind of love that Jesus showed when he walked the earth, that we would be humble, that we would see others as greater than ourselves, that we would desire to be in relationship with those that are not like us for the sole purpose of getting to know them, for the sole purpose of seeing them as your children, as created in your image. So God, forgive us for our sins. God, forgive us for how we've treated others in the past. And moving forward, God, just help us to live right in this world. God, help us to live differently. God, to live as you've called us to live, as your children, as those who love you and love others, that we love our neighbors ourselves. God, we love you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning as we continue our study in Titus, Paul's going to focus his attention on how mentoring and discipling others within the context of a local church will help us accomplish the mission I just talked about, the mission of loving others, the mission of as we love, we're able then to point people to Jesus. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them to the book of Titus and go to chapter 2. And as you're turning to chapter 2, in order to better understand what Paul wants us to learn today, we first need to recognize or admit that Christianity and the church, we have an image problem. In fact, if you don't believe that, just take a few seconds and look at this skit.
Proclaim your victory.
light for all to see. Oh God, it's you we need. Give us your mercy and give us your grace. Give us your kindness and show us.
Well, if you don't believe that we have an image problem, maybe now you can see why, at least from a Google standpoint. Okay, Google would say, which means the culture would say, we do have an image problem. In fact, Google's not the only one that would say we have an image problem. David Kinnaman, who is the president of the Barna Group, one of the leading research companies when it comes to church trends and church statistics and what culture thinks about churches. He wrote a book several years ago. He wrote a book titled Unchristian, what a new generation really thinks about Christianity and why it matters. Okay, why it matters. And in this book, he unpacks six negative images that people have of Christians. And some of them actually popped up in the video. And so let me just run through these six real quick. Things like churches and Christians tend to be hypocritical. Right? We tend to be hypocritical. We say one thing. We preach one thing. We say we stand for one thing, but then we go out and we live just the opposite. We say that Jesus is about love and grace and mercy and forgiveness. And then we go out and live a life that is anything but forgiving, that is anything but loving, that is anything but holy. Some would say we're too focused on getting converts. Outsiders sometimes feel like they're just simply targets, that we're only becoming their friend because we want them to, you know, we want to be able to say, I share with them the gospel. I led them to Jesus and look what I did. And I brought them to church and now we have their money. And that they just feel like a number. They're a number in our church directory. Some would also say, the culture would also say, and I might have to tend to agree with this one, that we are anti-homosexual, that we're homophobic, that we're anti-LGBTQ, to the point where we judge them and we don't show them much love and we actually don't want them in our churches. Others would say we're sheltered, and that might be why we're sheltered, right? We're old-fashioned, we're boring, we're actually out of touch with reality. We study and we read and we try to live the words that are in this ancient book that was written thousands of years ago. And so how in the world can this book written so long ago be relevant to today? So obviously we're out of touch and we're not willing to dive into the grit and the grime of people's lives. We sequester ourselves, right? We shelter ourselves. It's us for no more in our churches. And even if you want to come in, we're going to ask you to live a certain way and act a certain way before you're able to come in to our churches. We're too political. Outsiders often wonder, is our message about Jesus or is it about some right-winged agenda? Jesus, right-winged agenda. I don't know. I'll let you kind of answer that one. And then finally, Christians are just judgmental. We are angry. We're judgmental. We're condemning, right? Christians are quick to judge and slow to love, which really is the complete opposite of the message that Jesus taught. And so this morning, as we look at chapter 2 of Titus, we're going to look at some things that can help us. That can help us and can help the church change the narrative, because that's what we got to do. Here at the beginning of chapter 2, Titus is all about the church. And as we looked last week, we looked at individual characteristics. Those things that we, as individual followers of Jesus, need to work on. We need to work on these so that we can be a light, so that we can be a bright light, so we can point people to Jesus. And now he's going to take that to the next level. He's going to say, okay, as you do that, as you, as individual followers of Jesus, work on these characteristics, now I need you to think about that in terms of the whole church. I need those characteristics to become true of the whole church, Because why? The church has an image problem. The church is seen by our culture, seen by our society as being some of these things I just read. We're hypocritical, we're sheltered, we're judgmental, we're unloving, we're anti this, anti that. And so my hope at Parkside is that we would not be known for any of these things, but rather we would be known for things like being kind, being loving, being a safe place, being holy, being godly, being generous. Right? That's what my desires for Parkside. That's what I want our church to be known as. The kind of people to be simple, to maybe oversimplify it. Right? To be like Jesus, to do the things that Jesus did, to unconditionally love people regardless of how they behave, what they say, what they believe. Right? At least initially being accept them for who they are, and then allow them, love them, and then allow the Holy Spirit to do the work of the Holy Spirit. In our evangelism class, we defined evangelism as simply joining a conversation that the Holy Spirit's already having. So understanding that when we begin relationships with people, odds are the Holy Spirit is already working in their life. He's already doing his part in steering them toward Jesus, and we get to be a part of that. We get to enter that unique conversation. So the bottom line is this. The bottom line, what we need to understand, especially with what's going on right now, whether it's the pandemic or social injustice and protests and marches and Black Lives Matter, whatever it is, we need to understand now more than ever that we are being watched. As Christians and as churches, we are being watched and scrutinized, and people are looking and say, okay, how is the church going to respond to this? How is the church going to respond? Are they going to respond as Jesus, or are they going to respond in some other fashion? Right? We are being watched, especially by those who have not yet chosen Jesus. Why? Because they want to know. Because they want to know, do our actions match what we say we believe? Do our actions match what we say we believe? What we preach on Sundays, is that actually how we live on Mondays? And that was a problem here on the island of Crete. As we've discussed over the last couple weeks, the island of Crete, the believers on the island, the churches on the island of Crete were struggling with this concept of actually living out what they heard about from Jerusalem and the day of Pentecost and Jesus and the resurrection and the spread of the gospel. What they were hearing was not what was being taught by the current leadership of the church, and it was steering them in a direction again away from what Jesus taught, which meant for them that their actions were not matching what they said they believed. And so that's where Paul and Titus come in, and Paul and Titus went to this island, and Paul left Titus there with instructions to clean house and to establish a leadership that would help these churches begin to live out their faith, begin to live out the teachings of Jesus. Because again, people look at us, and for them, they want to be able to confirm. And for me, that they want to confirm that their suspicions are correct, that Christianity is simply a hoax. It's a hoax. It's a crutch. It's something that we as Christians lean on, right? We lean on this God who unconditionally loves us, and this heaven that we get to go to when we die, and all this stuff that makes us feel good. We lean on that. We lean on because it makes us feel better. It helps us deal with things like a pandemic. And it helps us, kind of turn a blind eye to social injustice, because we've got this Garden of Eden. We've got this heaven that we're trying to get to. And so they want to be able to confirm their suspicions about Christianity. In fact, even Paul acknowledges here at the beginning of Titus. Notice the progression of his letter to the believers in Crete. In verse 1, Paul insisted. He insisted upon belief that could be observed. Why? Because people were watching. The non-believers on Crete were watching these churches, and they were hearing what was being taught, and they were seeing what was being lived out, and the two didn't mesh. Right? And so Paul insisted. He insisted that your belief be observed so that you were able to show people exactly who Jesus was and what his teachings were all about, what the gospel is all about. And so that's why he directed Titus to come in and clean house and to appoint spiritual leaders whose behavior, when it was observed, could be recognized as above reproach or blameless. And then he commanded the Cretan leaders to silence those false teachers whose behavior didn't match the teachings of Jesus. And so finally, what we're going to see here in chapter 2 is Paul expressing his desire for each church to pursue godly behavior in 5 different relational areas, but for 3 main reasons. And you're going to see this kind of peppered throughout these verses that we're going to look at here this morning. 3 main reasons why we need to make sure relationally within the confines of the church that we live out what we say we believe, that we model what we say we believe, that we teach, that we show others how to live like Jesus. One is so that the word of God won't be dishonored, to give credibility to the word of God. Secondly, so that anyone who opposes Christianity will have nothing critical to say about the church. In other words, if they want to be critical of Christianity, it can't be because of how the church lives out its mission. Right? We don't want the church to be a stumbling block to anyone coming to faith in Jesus. And then finally, so people will be attracted to Jesus. Because if we can take away all their excuses, then there's very little reason why someone shouldn't at least explore Jesus more and maybe even come to a saving faith in Jesus. You see, the character of the church is being watched both from the outside and to be honest, it's also being watched from the inside. So as we look at Titus 2:1, we're going to see Paul kind of separate. He's going to separate chapter 1 from chapter 2. And so let's go ahead and dive in here. Go to verse 16, chapter 1. Let's go ahead and start with this last verse. Paul writes this: such people claim they know God. Now, these such people are these false teachers that he has just gotten through describing as teachers that are greedy, that lead out of fear and coercion, that lead people away from grace and lead them into law, right? So he's saying such people claim they know God, but they deny him by the way they live. They're detestable, disobedient, worthless for doing anything good. And then he starts off chapter 2 with these words: but as for you, right? These are the false leaders. This is how they live their lives. They're detestable. They're disobedient. They're worthless. But you, Titus, as for you, you are to promote the kind of living. You're to teach the kind of living. You're to train these leaders, these new church leaders, to be the kind of leaders that reflect wholesome teaching. Right? That's Titus, what I need you to do. Now let me just stop here for just a minute. Because I think sometimes we forget. We forget the true purpose of meeting together. The true purpose of gathering together. I mean, right now, more than ever, we'd love to be together. I totally understand that. But why? I mean, if I were to ask a question and you know, if we were really a social media driven church, I mean, if we were on top of things, I could throw out this question and I could have you know, text your answers to, you know, 4745, and all of a sudden I could put up on the screen, hey, here's the results of our poll as to why you go to church on Sunday morning. That we'd have everything from singing to seeing my friends to studying God's word, right? So I get all that, right? We attend church, singing, prayer, listening to a nice sermon, talking with friends. But how many of us would type in, so I can learn how to be a better follower of Jesus? Or this one, so I can be convicted of where I've messed up and where I and what areas of my life I need to work on. I think very few of us would type that in as a reason for coming to church, yet that really is the reason. Don't forsake the assembling of ourselves together. Why? Because we need to do 2 things when we come together. We need to encourage one another, and we need to pray for one another, and in that prayer, we need to help each other become better followers of Jesus. We need to encourage and build up and pray and push each other to become more like Jesus. That's the reason for gathering together, so that we can become better followers of Jesus. Why? Again, so we can point people toward Jesus. This is really what sets the church apart. I mean, think about this. The church, I think, if I look at the number of churches and the number of people that attend the Christian church, I think we're the largest learning institution in the entire world today. Right? We've got to be the largest learning institution. And so, with that said, I don't know how you can't say then that the church is the only hope the world has. Right? The church has got to be, the local church has got to be seen as the hope of the world. It can't be seminaries. It can't be conferences. It can't be denominations. It can't be whatever latest church growth fad is out there. It's got to just be the simple fact that it's got to be just churches staying on mission, staying within Acts 1:8, the Great Commission. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, right? Teaching them to obey all things, right? Just making disciples who make disciples. But then also, the second commandment, right? Love your neighbor as yourself. To me, that's the church being the church. When we love God and love others, then we're right where we need to be as a church. And that is what will change a culture. That's what will set an entire world on its head. That will make the world stand up and look at churches and look beyond churches and see Jesus and say, okay, I want some of that. Every week, Christians all around the world gather together to learn what we're doing right and praise God, while also learning about where we might improve and praise God, and then ask God to help us to live better, right? Those 15 things I talked about last week, those 15 character traits that can help us change a city, change a nation, change a world. So, again, he starts off by saying, okay, Paul, Titus, this is what's wrong with the churches on Crete, and it starts with the leadership, and this is why I need you to be different. I need you to be a different leader. I need you to be a leader that promotes the kind of living that reflects healthy instruction. And so then from there, he's going to ask Titus to divide each congregation, to take these churches, and say, okay, as a single church, right, as Parkside Fellowship, I'm going to divide you into 5 relational categories, and I'm going to spend some time talking to each one of you, to each one of those segments of Parkside Fellowship. And we're going to touch on 3 of them. There's 5, but we're going to touch on 3 because 3 of them is what makes up the majority of our church. The other 2 is in the future, so I'm not going to talk too much about it because it's future. But I'm going to talk about 3. And so let's go ahead and dive in. Go to Titus 2, chapter 2. He's going to start with the older men, right? So Paul's going to start by talking to the older men in our church, which for us is pretty much 99.9% of our church falls into the older man category. And I know, let me just, a little side note, Roger and I, our council, we get it. We get it that is not the ideal for Parkside Fellowship, that we need to become a church that reaches a younger audience, that is intergenerational, that has babies and toddlers and elementary and middle school and junior high and high school and college and young singles and young marrieds and you know, middle-aged and then older. I get that. We need to have all that. Senior adults, we need to have all of that. But until God does that, until God brings us those people, what I want us to do now while we're waiting is to prepare ourselves. To prepare ourselves for when that day comes, for when those young families walk through our door, I want us to be ready. I want us to, from a spiritual sense, be ready to do what God has called us to do, what God's calling us to do here in Titus chapter 2, verse 2, where he's going to say this. He tells Titus to teach the older men to exercise self-control. There's 6 things, 6 characteristics that he's going to tell them these older men need to have in their lives. They need to exercise self-control, right? A life characterized by balance and moderation. A life that's worthy of respect, right? To be worthy of respect and to live wisely, to make sensible and sound decisions. How do you do that? They must have a sound faith, right? To make decisions based on God's word. And when we base things on God's word, then those last 2 just naturally happen there at the end of verse 2. We will be filled with love and patience. As we live out the gospel, as we read the teachings of Jesus, we can't help but be more loving, and we can't help but be more patient. So these are the 6 characteristics that Paul is saying, Titus, these are the characteristics that a mature male believer needs to have as a part of his life. He needs to have self-control. He needs to live a life worthy of respect. He needs to live wisely and make sound decisions. He needs to have a sound, God-centered faith. He needs to be filled with love. And finally, he needs to live a life filled with patience. Now, what are we supposed to do with that? Okay, you're like Doug. Okay, last week you gave us 15 things we need to work on, and now there's another six. If we're an old guy, here's another six that I'm supposed to work on. Okay, now I got 21 things I need to work on. What's the point? What's this all about? At the end of the day, what am I working towards? Well, here's what you're working towards. Drop down to verse 7. Well, actually, verse 6. Okay, he goes from verse 2 to verses 3, 4, and 5 where he's talking to women. But then he says this, in the same way, right? He's just got through telling older women that they are to train and teach younger women. And so then he says in verse 6, in the same way, encourage the young men. So in the same way, older men, you are to encourage young men. You're to encourage young men to live wisely. And you yourself must be an example to them by doing good works of every kind. Let everything you do reflect the integrity and seriousness of your teaching. Teach the truth so that your teaching can't be criticized. Then those who oppose us will be ashamed and have nothing bad to say about us. Again, if you're an older guy, let your life reflect the six characteristics of a mature man. Why? Because when these young men, whether they're single, married, kids, no kids, when they walk through our door, I want us to be ready. I want the men of Parkside Fellowship to be ready to come alongside them, to teach them, to train them, to mentor them, to disciple them. Right? The last part of the Great Commission, teaching them to obey all things, to teach the younger men how to live out their faith, how to live out their faith in their marriages, how to live out their faith in the workplace, how to live out their faith with their kids, how to live out their faith as they make decisions. And who better to do that than us? Who better to do that than you? Someone who has already lived through those stages of life. Someone who has already struggled to balance faith in Jesus with the grime and the grit of real life, filled with kids and marriage and work and all these responsibilities that come along with that. Right? You've lived that. And so now what I need is I need us to be ready. To be ready to be an example to these young men as they walk through the door. And I already talked about that. He says the same thing about older women. Go back up to verse 3. He's going to start out with the word similarly. Similarly. In other words, suggesting that the qualities for the older women are in fact parallel with those of the older men. Well, the older men are to exercise self-control and live a life worthy of respect and make sound decisions and have love and patience. Older women, he says this, teach the older women to live in a way that honors God. Way that honors God. They are not to slander others. In other words, they're not to spend their time just gossiping and talking bad about others. They're not to be heavy drinkers, or at least I might broaden that a little bit and say, don't be addicted to anything. Don't be addicted to any substances, right? Don't live a destructive lifestyle. Instead, they should teach others. Teach others what is good. In fact, these older women, verse 4, these older women must train the younger women to love their husbands and their children, to live wisely, to be pure, to work in their homes, to do good, and to be submissive to their husbands. Then, why? Because then they will not bring shame on the word of God. Then they will not bring shame on the word of God. Now, rather than get caught up in that list, again, I don't want to spend much time on what younger women are supposed to do because none of us are in that boat, all right? So let me just say this. Rather than get caught up in the list, allow me simply to say this when it comes to the relationship between older women and younger women. Again, as we grow younger as a church, and as young families and as singles walk through our door, as young moms walk through our church door, they're going to need older women. They're going to need older women to come alongside them, to show them how to love God, how to balance career and life. And whether you like it or not, these young women, they're going to want to know, and they may even ask you, hey, Tom, I'm struggling to raise my kids. I'm struggling. My husband doesn't help me. I'm working a full-time job. I'm trying to raise my kids in the ways of God. And I'm done, right? They're going to throw up their hands and say, I'm done. Tell me what I'm supposed to do. You need to be prepared to be able to take them out to coffee, to take them out to breakfast or lunch, and just sit down and listen to them And then as you listen, to begin to pour into them, to begin to share with them the wisdom of what you have learned as you yourself have struggled and overcome living out your faith as a young woman and as a young wife and as a mom and as a career lady. You've learned how to juggle all that. And so don't get caught up. Don't get caught up in the fact that we don't even have young women here right now, but begin to prepare yourselves now. In fact, let me say this, okay? Before we move on to the next category, let me say this to both our older men and our older women, which is almost everybody, all right? Let me just say this, all right? Don't wait. Don't wait for the young families and singles to begin walking through our door. Find somebody now. Find somebody now that you can begin to mentor, that you can begin to talk with about how they're doing, how they're juggling life, whatever life may bring it at them. Find somebody that you can begin to talk to. And if you begin to talk life with them, I'm quite certain Jesus will come up in the conversation, because they're going to ask you, well, man, how did you deal with this? How did you deal with an unloving husband? How did you deal with a husband that doesn't seem to care? How do you deal with kids that are unruly? How do you juggle that and work? And you're going to be able to say, you know what? It's hard. But you know who helped me get through it? Jesus did. And they're going to say, Jesus, what do you mean? What does Jesus have to do with my husband? And then you can share with them. You can share with them how, through the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus was able to help you, to give you the patience and the guidance on how to be the young man or the young woman that God is calling all of us to be. So begin to do it now, right? Because none of us are done. You may be retired in terms of work, and you may be retired in terms of raising kids, but you're not retired in terms of being a disciple of Jesus, in terms of being a follower of Jesus, who are called to disciple others, who are called to mentor and train others, as Paul and Titus point out here in Titus chapter 2. Well, again, there's one more category that Paul's going to write to. And it's slaves. It's slaves, or another term might be bondservant. Or today, you know what? Today, it's employees. That's the best we have, because we don't have slaves. We don't have slaves. We don't have bondservants. But what we do have is we have employees, right? You may still be an employee. You may be someone who feels like, yeah, I'm a slave. From 9 to 5, hey, my company, my boss absolutely owns me. I feel trapped in my workplace. So here's what Paul's going to write to you that are still in the workforce, to you that feel trapped, to you that feel like you there's no escape from the turmoil that you find yourselves in at work. Here's what Paul's going to write in Titus 2, beginning at verse 9. Titus chapter 2, verse 9. Paul writes this: slaves must always obey their masters. Slaves must always obey their masters and do their best to please them. They must not talk back or steal, but must show themselves to be entirely trustworthy and good. Now remember, think about this for a second. Think about who Paul was writing to. Paul's writing this to slaves. Slaves. And slaves in the first century were literally pieces of property. I'm not even sure they were considered real humans. They were pieces of meat. They were individuals that if a slave owner wanted to, could kill and not even blink an eye. Not even have to worry about the law or repercussions or anything coming about killing their slave. It was just the way it was in the Roman society there in the first century. So this is who Paul's writing to. To these slaves who are living in that type of oppression. Paul says this. He says, you know what? Obey your masters. Do the best to please them. Don't talk back. Don't steal. Show yourself to be trustworthy and good. Because Paul understands, if we want to make a difference, if we want to make a difference in our world, in our culture, in our society, then it starts by addressing those topics. Addressing topics like this. Addressing topics like social injustice and racism and bigotry and whatever the hot button topic is. It's addressing it in terms of what the Bible says, in terms of how God's word says we are to react. And then watch as people kind of scratch their head and be like, okay, wait a minute. You got to unpack that for me, because I don't quite understand what that means. Okay, what you're saying, Jesus said this? This is how Jesus says we are to respond. That's what Paul was doing. Paul was diving into these hot button taboo type topics in order to begin to make a difference for Jesus. And so here he's giving five or six things, depending on how you read it, he's giving five or six things that we can do without even preaching, right? Just by the way we act. I mean, look at how verse 10 ends. Okay, he says, okay, do what you're told, do it with excellence, don't talk back, don't steal, don't borrow things without permission, be trustworthy. Why? Then they will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. He says, when you live like this, the teaching about God becomes attractive in every single way. Not by what you say, but simply by how you live. How do we make God's word attractive? We live it out. We allow our actions to speak for themselves when it comes to God's word. And then we really don't have to explain it because people will be like, well, yeah, I want that. I want that kind of peace. I want that kind of hope. I want that kind of happiness. How do I get that? We can, without words, share the story of Jesus with our employer and with our coworker simply by how we live out our lives. Because, again, to kind of come full circle, whether you like it or not, we're all being watched. So let me close with this story. An old story of St. Francis of Assisi tells of a day when he said to one of his young students, so this older man, right, case in point, this older man, looks at this young friar and he says, come with me. Let's go down to the village and preach to the people who need a savior. And so off they went, right? Off they went, this young man following this older man. And he's going to watch this St. Francis of Assisi. And I'm sure he's taking notes, right? In terms of, okay, this is how you preach a message of the gospel of Jesus to a crowd. He's ready to go. And so this is how this story goes. Once at the gate, they stopped, and they bent down to speak kind words to a crippled old man and gave him a cool drink of water and a few coins. And then they saw some children playing with a ball out in the field. And so they joined their game and had fun with the children. I mean, just imagine that. Just because when you think of St. Francis of Assisi, do you really think soccer player? Right? Can you picture St. Francis of Assisi out playing some kickball with a bunch of kids? Right? But this is what he did. When he saw some children playing with a ball in the field, he joined their game. He laughed. He had fun with the children. This is St. Francis of Assisi playing kickball. And while they played, a lonely widow, watching at her doorstep, drew their attention. So again, they're playing kickball, but off to the side, they see this widow that they want to go talk to. And so as soon as they're done playing, they go and they talk with her. It says when they finished the game, they visited with her, bringing a few words of cheer and encouragement to the old lady living alone. A fearful young man lurked in the shadows, ashamed of what he had done the night before, right? So they're talking to this widow, and then even off to the side, as they're talking to this widow, is a young man lurking, right? He's crushed because of how he's lived his life. So just think about this sequence for a second. Let's stop there. I mean, there's more, but let me just stop there and just kind of walk you through where we've gone so far. So they got to the gate. They saw a homeless man. They knelt, right? They gave him some water. They gave him some money. Then they saw some kids off in the distance playing some kickball. So they went and they joined them. And as they're running up and down the field, they see a widow off to the side. So they go and they talk with her. And as they're talking with her, they see another guy that just seems like his world's come crashing down on him. And so they go over to him. And they prayed with him. And they spoke with him openly and freely about forgiveness and grace and mercy. And they encouraged him to pursue a more productive future. And then, on the way out of town, they stopped at a small store, right? Because they're hungry. They want an ice cream cone. So they're going to stop at a store and they're going to greet the merchant. And as they're talking to this merchant, they ask about his family. And they thanked him for his faithful work through the years. And finally, as they're leaving this small store, St. Francis looks at his young protege. He says, okay, time to go back home, right? I'm tired. I don't know about you, but I'm tired. I mean, we talked to a homeless guy at the gate, and we played some kickball. We talked to a widow. We prayed with her. We We tried to provide some encouragement to a man whose life just crashed around him. We just spent some time talking to a store clerk, and I'm done, I'm tired. St. Francis wants to go home. So he says, let's go back. Well, the novice, right, this young protege, this young pastor, this young friar, he stops. He says, but wait a minute. I had my notebook out. I got my pen. I'm ready to take notes on what it means to preach the gospel. When do we get to preach? Right? When do we get to preach? The older friar answered, every step we took, were you not paying attention? Right? I just picture St. Francis of Assisi. Have you not been paying attention? Every step we took, every word we spoke, every action we did has been a sermon. Right? Every step we took, every word we spoke, every action we did has been a sermon. In other words, the most effective presentation of the gospel begins with a Christ-like life. The most effective presentation of the gospel begins when we live like Jesus. The most effective presentation of the gospel begins when we look for others that we can mentor, that we can train, that we can teach, that we can show the word of God to by simply by how we live our lives. And then the story closes. Therefore, the defining character of the church should be everyday authentic godliness. It starts with individuals, but really, as we think about our own lives and as we work on those characteristics, those Jesus characteristics in our own life, we also need to think about them in terms of the global church. Because as I started this message again, the church has an image problem. We have an image problem. I mean, David Kinneman says it in his book on Christian. The church is known for being judgmental, for being hypocritical, for being unloving, for being too political, for being anti-this and anti-that. So we've got to change the image of the church, especially in today's divided world that we find ourselves in. How can we best be a light to a world divided? By remaining unified. By remaining unified as followers of Jesus. And so that's my hope, and that's my prayer for Parkside. My prayer for Parkside is that we would seek to live lives as a church family that serves to confirm what we teach, that confirms what we believe, as we desire to live out our faith in Jesus every single day. Let's allow our actions to confirm our beliefs. Thanks for joining me this morning. Let me close this out in a time of prayer, and then we're going to have there'll be a song that, again, is simply there for you to meditate on. You can sing with the words. You can simply meditate, but just, again, to kind of think through what you've heard this morning. Maybe jot down some ways that you can be a better light, some things that you can work on. Someone, write down some names of someone maybe that you can come alongside and begin to mentor and begin to train and to teach to be more like Jesus. Let me pray for us. Oh, Heavenly Father, God, I pray for our church. I pray for Parkside. God, as a local church here on Erickson Avenue, I pray that we would be unified in our spirit, that we'd be unified in our actions, that we'd be unified in our words. Lord, for the church, other churches that meet on our campus, that we together would be unified. God, that in our unity, that people that walk through our campus over to Schiffler Park, that those at Beaverton High School, that those that live in the apartments across the street, would see a unified presence, a unified body of Jesus followers that simply want to love and forgive and extend grace and mercy to others, to provide hope for those that live up and down Erickson Avenue and Hazel and Bertold and all the streets that are around us. Lord, I also pray for the church, the global church. Lord, that you would help us during crazy times like this, God, to remain unified, to not get lost, to not let the Great Commission and the Great Commandment get lost in rhetoric, to get lost in violence, to get lost in judgment. God, but that we would remain focused on you, that we would remain focused on spreading hope. God, you said that you will build a church that the gates of hell will not be able to and will not be able to conquer. God, I pray that that would remain true. God, that Satan would not get a foothold into the church, that, God, we would remain steadfast, that we would remain confident in you, confident in your presence, confident in your power, confident in your spirit. Lord, continue to bless us as a church and continue to bless us as your children. Lord, we love you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.